from the last regular committee of the whole meeting held May 15, 2018, and the special committee of the whole meeting held May 14, 2018, be confirmed as written and filed.
All in favor, council? Opposed, bid? Motion's carried. Okay, we have a couple of applications. The first application, Mary Wooden, on the age-friendly steering committee.
Good morning. Thank you for this opportunity to tell you about World Elder Abuse Awareness Day, which this year is June 15th. My name, as you may have heard, is Mary Bodden, and I'm co-chair of the Kenora Age-Friendly Steering Committee, along with Lynn Moffett of Community... I seem to be more tipsy than I usually am at this hour. Who knew? Anyway, with Lynn Moffett from Community Support Services and Judy Underwood, who's with the Northwest Health Unit. And you'll recall that the Age-Friendly Steering Committee arose out of a community response to a grant opportunity from the Senior Secretariat about 3 years ago of the provincial government to develop a strategic plan for an age-friendly Kenora. The city of Kenora was a partner, and Councillor McMillan and Jennifer Findlay were members of that process. Currently, Councillor McMillan and Adam Smith are city representatives and active members of our committee. I'm also chair of our subcommittee on elder abuse. As there is a lack of any identified person or group prepared to help individuals experiencing elder abuse in Kenora, this subcommittee was to develop a formalized strategy. Elder abuse refers to intentional or negligent acts by a trusted individual or caregiver that causes harm to an older person. Elder abuse occurs in all cultures and economic groups and across settings. It takes many forms, including neglect or isolation, physical abuse, sexual abuse, financial abuse and exploitation, and emotional or psychological abuse, which includes threats. So our committee is comprised of individuals from the financial sector, community policing, legal profession, social work, women's shelter, nursing, Alzheimer's Society, and long-term care homes. We're about to survey those working in businesses and health services to determine the extent to which those entities are aware of elder abuse and have policies, procedures, or strategies to identify and report suspected cases of elder abuse. We all deserve to live happy, healthy lives free from abuse as we age, yet older people are mistreated more often than we think. We are all born with the same human rights that should be enjoyed at any stage of our lives. When ageism, which is negative stereotypes based on prejudices about age, is directed at older people, it drives discrimination and denial of our human rights as we age. So we need to end ageism and make our society and this community of Kenora more just. Thank you for this opportunity to speak to you about the important challenge of our community and remind you about World Elder Abuse Day this coming June 15th, next week. Any questions?
Thanks, Mary. Questions, council? Okay, number two, the Tornstein Asset Management Plan presentation.
Thank you very much, Heather. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
That's Thanks, John. Any questions, Council? Councilor Smith?
So this may be more of a question for Karen. Thank you for the presentation. I found it very informative, John. Karen, when it talks about the reallocation of the debt payments once the debt is paid down, that's assuming now that we take on no more new debt in the future.
Yes, but that is also a standard city practice, so we only draw on the debt payments for the capital and debt maturity, so we can go back to the capital to draw on the And if it makes sense, John, you can go for the jumping here, but if you have any sense, we can issue debt to do some of that life cycle maintenance and pay down the debt instead of allowing the capital to create such that we're having to do some damage.
Yeah, and that makes sense. But the important message here is the more debt we take on, the less we're going to be able to deal with the infrastructure deficit. So it's going to be important to remember that going forward.
Depending on what you're, yeah.
Yeah, of course, but we've always got to keep that in the back of our mind. And, you know, like, for me, as a counselor, it's been really hard to, especially with the water and the wastewater, to keep pushing forward with the recommendations about driving money into the rate increases. It has been hard, but the presentation like this shows that, you know, when you set those kind of goals, it is really important for this community that we stick to our objectives to make sure that we keep those assets in good condition for the community. So it's important for us around council table to remember that and not to try and back off.
Okay, let's, Councilor Smith, could we have questions?
No, I'm fine. So, no, I'm good. So somebody else can have that question.
Any other questions, Council? John, Mayor Dave here. Thank you very much. That's very informative, and I was going to say I'm glad to say our neighbors are doing as bad or worse than us, but I'm not really. And I'm sure you've heard this lots too. That it's and with the proposal from AMO in Ontario, there's a huge need here for the upper levels of government to jump in and be part of this solution.
Yeah, absolutely. And I apologize. I'm the slight tough time during all of the conversations there. I do have my phone on max volume, but yeah, absolutely. I think the problem is coming down to the law of regulation for municipalities for asset management planning, but I think being one thing as well is they are rolling out some money to help municipalities achieve that as well. So at least that seems to be, and there are grants available for some FCM as well to help municipalities achieve those asset management goals. So at least that has been a good balance of regulation with money available to help communities get there as well.
Thanks, John.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So you don't have to wait till the end of the meeting, Rotary. I understand you have a presentation. Please come forward.
Change, I believe, in the bank account, plus the petroleum grant, and that's
some and be in more trouble. But thank you very much. It's an amazing project, and in fact, one of the exhibitors at FCM in Halifax, me and Councilor McMillan were just down there. We happen to be talking about it because it happens to be the people, I think, that have the equipment. Very good. Thank you. And now we'll go to, we're going to jump in the, if Council okay, to 4.6 on the agenda under the bylaw, recreation of parking lots. So who's looking after 4.6? Charlotte or? Council, we're okay with moving ahead with awarding that?
I just have a question about the change order process. So the total contract with taxes is $538,000. So you go up and we're going to award the tender today, correct? Or we're going to approve the tender? And it'll go through next 2 weeks' time. So what does the contractor, if we have 450, say, raised to date, does the contractor just pick and choose what doesn't? I want to understand as a council. So it's not going to cause any issues for the park to proceed. Okay.
Start from the ground and work up. Okay, Council?
I have one other question. Under the budget, the City of Kenora is going to perform $50,000 worth of money.
So that $50,000 is a separate budget allocation that is important to Washington Festival and providing a special control for the and the Washington. And that was something that the city is also
so anybody that uses the splash park will also have access to proper facilities.
Correct.
Good. Thank you very much.
Well done.
But part of it is you got to stay for the whole meeting.
Good luck, eh?
Spread the word.
Now you have to spread the word.
Yeah, spread the good word.
Yeah, you betcha. You
okay. We'll get right into finance and admin and the financial statements. John,
yeah.
I didn't even see you back there when you stood up.
Without going into detail, everything, I think the big thing to note here, expenses are under budget in all of our segments. At the end
mostly good news, so you're okay. Not that it's got anything to do with you. It's all good. It's all good.
I've got a question.
Yeah. Question, Councilor Ennis?
John, on the user fees for water and sewer.
Yes.
$1 million higher than comparative year to date last year. So is there just something changed in the way we're recording revenues? So our revenues really aren't, because we're always a month behind, right? Could that be confirmed before?
Thanks, John. Railway rights of way. I like this. We're still working on the high volume. I'm not sure that we will quite make it. The numbers are, not sure what our numbers are in tonnage.
Yeah.
So in trains, so. Right.
They did, when I spoke to the Ministry of Finance, they could confirm that at least one property was considered high volume.
Yeah.
So that's the
volume. Exactly. Mm-hmm. And when you think, well, this is one of the things. If the public wants to know what does NOMA do for you, this is where this come from, and I have to congratulate Ken Perry, Councillor in Port Francis, who brought this to, he's on the NOMA board. We've been working on this now for a few years, and because Manitoba, Saskatchewan, Alberta are on per ton, they get way more. So this is not over yet, and when you think of facilities that are out there paying $7,900 in taxes, most people on our lake pay that much. And when you think about it in that perspective, they've gotten a free ride for a long time in the province of Ontario. And I have to say, even AMO, all the caucuses being on side, Phnom, Roma, of course, not so much the large urban because they're on a different system down there. That's why we always say this one size doesn't fit all. So, I mean, this is what your municipal organizations do for you. We would not have this if it wasn't for NOMA. And Ken Perry. Good news story. Okay. We don't want to turn it down, do we? Okay, 1.3. John, you're back up.
Yes. This is Ontario Regulation 34. Ontario Regulation 284.09 requires that the city prepare a report showing the impact of the capital budget on the city's ending surplus. So that's all this is. If anybody has any questions on that.
Good council. Great. We'll move on before the change of mind. Okay, 1.4. Community Foundation Club support. Charlotte?
Okay, so currently the community
all good news, doesn't matter how much.
Exactly.
Okay, 1.5.
And this is an agreement with Monday Tell, and it's gonna be enabling them to provide telecommunications services to the city as well, regarding.
That's because of the not-for-profit. Any questions? MCM Advisory Fund request.
What I'd like is just, this is a special fund that was established by MCM, which is called the municipalities to support this special fund.
It's one of them ones too that, there's gonna be some more requests, as there was at the NOMA meeting, towards Common Voices. When you take a look and you see what we've achieved by being members of FCM, for $1,000, it's pretty hard to say no for the amount of money and the payback that we've got by being partners with the FCM. So I think it's money very well spent.
This isn't addition to our membership.
Yes, absolutely, yeah. Yeah, some special projects quite often, and this is what we did some time ago back, with the Common Voice, that grew out of the Free Rendezvous, and put some money forward to, you know, a different lobbying effort that doesn't come out of your general revenue sort of thing. So it's another fund that's required. Okay.
Yeah, and I think the other fact is now that we've got third vice president is from Northwestern Ontario.
Yes.
We can lean on that position.
Yolene won the third vice. Okay, 1.7, KDMA request for funds. I know there's not a strong recommendation here. I again, for $1,000, am going to, and in these discussions, and being the largest community, I think it's showing, it's $1,000. I think we would be showing the leadership role to step up relatively quickly, or instead of waiting on this. It's not a lot, and that's to, so we can actually get a website up that people can actually go on, because right now we just don't have the resources for the money that's taken into KDMA. And we might have been a little upset with this back at the KDMA conference. We probably saved enough money there with $1,000. It's not a whole lot of money.
Yeah, I had a problem. My concern is with the rationale for saying no. It wasn't considered our budget, well, neither was the one we just approved. And if the money's going to come out of the same way, we are, I strongly follow what you're suggesting. I support that. I think, you know, if we're going to make KDMA stronger, then Kenora has to be a big part of that.
You have to be the leader.
So I'm fine with the money coming out from the same,
yeah,
our council donations.
You okay with that?
I concur.
Okay, municipal insurance renewal. Bruce.
For unmanned aerial vehicle
bumps that number up a bit.
Almost doubled.
Yeah, it goes down there.
So, yeah, so the recommendation is that we proceed with the loan with coverage to Cal and we deal with the local workers.
Councilman Gillum?
Just a curiosity question, Bruce, and I support moving ahead with it. I think locally with Sheldon McCool, who's our strong advocate for insurance, but just scanning the equipment, I noticed that, and it's probably this was done before that, that the new piece of fire equipment is not included in that, like the new vehicle, is it?
I believe it is, and that's.
Oh, it is?
Yeah, she was surprised that it didn't go up more, but yeah, they the fire truck is.
Okay, good enough.
Any other questions on the Cowan? Nice pictures they had there.
Yeah,
oh, sorry, Councilor Ray.
This question is to finance. So when we built the budget, is it date, did we have these rates at the time? So. Okay, so. Some of it spread through sewer and water, so it's not. Okay.
Thank you.
No, I'm not going to say that. I'm going to talk about the rate. I'm not going to talk about the rate. I want to be the bad omen.
Okay.
Next one, 1.9. Adam, everyone that's audited information, you're up.
No, this is
Adam McCarron, yeah.
This report just illustrates the progress made in terms of implementing the recommendations from the government's report done in April 2015. So by and large, you see that almost all the items have been completed. The one being the council orientation is still being under development, but for the most part, we've been pretty well.
Good report, Councilor Mill. When I saw that on the agenda and I started looking at the report, I thought, uh-oh, where are we going?
Yeah.
And then I read it complete. It brought back a lot of thoughts about the discussions we had, and interesting. It can serve as this type of report can serve as a good base document as we start looking at, or a follow-up council starts looking at changes. They can go back and look at this information and have that dialogue. If they do.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry.
No, go ahead, sure.
I think that bringing in George Cuff to do that governance audit and presentation, for me, it made a difference as to coming into a council and knowing the protocol and that. And I suggest that we do that again with every new council. Because councilors come in, they have an idea of how council works and what their job is. And I hear it from the smallest ones that don't do that. And they're in trouble because they don't recognize their role as counselor. So I thought that was a good exercise, and it always should be part of an orientation, just to have an expert like him come to talk. I think it's well worth the money,
yep.
You know, that you spend, because it saves a lot of aggravation, and everybody knows their roles moving forward. And like I said, I see the smaller municipalities that don't do that and probably can't afford to do that. Some of the issues they have to deal with because of that.
And it doesn't necessarily have to be George Cuff, who's all correct.
Somebody.
Even Abel does,
yeah.
Most of that, or pretty much all of that stuff. Mm-hmm. Yeah, someone closer, and then of course it makes more affordable. Good, all good. Okay, FCM, MCIP Climate Staff Grant Application.
This report is just to apply for
is wrong.
No matter what, it's going to be a change.
It's going to be a change, absolutely, yeah. Well, that's good. It'll be interesting, and of course, we'll know on Thursday. And going through this is kind of like, who have we got? Who are we going to have for ministers for what? Because we're not going to know that for, I would imagine, a week or so. And then hopefully we have a minister from Kenora. Work out very well. That's what we know. But I didn't say which party.
No,
I'm saying who's winning.
I'm not entering the political arena on that one. Adam, on the healthcare one, I think I can provide you some updated information. And if time permits, I'd like to circulate some positions to see how the cross-border discussions are going so we can update them.
Yeah, so we do have some time. I think it's early July, which for submissions. So, yeah. I'll do a follow-up email.
Yeah, things could change. There is no doubt going to be a change of government, and you don't know, what direction they're going to go. I'm assuming everything will stay the same. It's, because it's pretty common practice, like the MOU. But okay. Okay, asset management plan. 113.
Riley, this report is just approving the asset management plan as presented by Hope Center Digest. And this is part of the background level of service work, as well as part of the funding and work around our listening diseases.
It was great. I just want to thank staff for the pat on the back they got from John, because everybody's doing a job above our, definitely well above average for the rest of the communities in Canada. So that's good to hear. Thank you very much. Okay, fire and emergency services. Chief.
Just some changes in our diesel tariffs for part three in our emergency services. I was approached by ambulance, or EMS. They put on a third shift now, however, the building can't handle having a third shift. They don't have parking facilities.
I see that.
But they approached me and additionally, we've been doing this for a while now, just into our training. I added in $150 per student for training on site, or as a cost of time. Just wanted to have that. It's going to be a general problem.
That's good. Any questions? Perfect. Okay. Operations and infrastructure 3.1. Lakeview Drive. Thank you very much. 3.2. I'm sorry, Jeff. Go ahead.
Seems to be a big fuss about this. Again, I don't understand how this is back here over this 800-meter stretch. I drove it this morning. I measured it out at 800 meters. I would imagine we're saving about 10 seconds for people traveling there. Notwithstanding the very narrow bike path that's on the bridge that reduces down to about 16 to 18 inches, we have two parking lots on the north side of the road. I understand the reference that we're trying to steer people under the road to get to Husky the Muskie, but as any engineer knows, the shortest path is the one that people will take, and that is across the road. As we have a city parking lot that I have my pass for harborfront docking, I get a parking space on that side of the road, which I have to cross. I noticed six vehicles this morning parked on that stretch. I think it's still well used. As we start to make more events that draw people into the harbor front to the tent, I think you're going to have more and more of that problem. originally, I sat on the tech team with the planning of the Big Spruce, which was two councils ago, I think. And the plan was always to put a crossing west of the bypass, or west of the roundabout. And that was to be built into the future plans. So I think the future plans call for a more of a pedestrianization of that area, and I think reducing the speed, or increasing the speed back to 50, just seems a little bit, I don't understand it. I haven't had any complaints about it. The only people I've heard it from are Councillor Mellon and the mayor. I can't vote for this.
Councillor Reynard and then Councillor Mellon.
Yeah, I don't understand the process, how it got back here. Like, I look back at the, you know, when we changed this, based on deputations that came forward, we changed it 3 years ago, and the rationale for changing it, nothing has changed. So Councillor McMillan brought it up last meeting, and there was a lukewarm response from the rest of council. So I'm curious, how did this end up back in front of us? I just don't see any change that's occurred in those 3 years. Why we did it before to chip. So I'm not really a strong supporter of the change.
That's my vote. Well, I guess it's interesting that it's been pointed at me.
I know, Dan.
You were the one that brought it forward at council.
And I know there was a discussion. I didn't anticipate any report. I know I brought it forward as a notice of motion 2 or 3 years ago, and nobody would second it. So I thought there was just general dialogue at the last meeting about the speed, and I made a comment respectfully to staff that brought it forward for discussion.
Your words have weight, I guess, Rory.
Well, I'll take blame because I've brought it up many times. Yeah. I've brought it up many times. I've had a lot of complaints, and it's one of them ones that they're not going away. I keep getting complaints about it. And the issue, I think, is the 40 kilometers. When there's heavy traffic and there's events, you're probably going 20 or 30. You're not going 40. The big complaint that I get from people is when there's nobody around and the police are sitting in the old Midtown Motors, and it's 40, when you could do 50, there's nothing wrong with doing 50. And 50 is still the maximum, remember. So, I mean, people are ticked because when there's no traffic, they're crawling along 40 kilometers an hour. That's what people are ticked about. I have not had anybody come and say, oh, is that ever a great thing to do? Everybody, and as I say, it hasn't gone away. And I've brought it up different times because if there's nobody around and there's very slow traffic, what's the problem? Because when there's less traffic, you're doing 10, 20, 30. Like in the summertime, you're not going to do 50 there unless it's in the nighttime or somewhere like that. And that's the big complaint that I've got from people.
Just talking about that, I
Please say that to me, Councillor Johnson.
I live on the Carlton Road, which last year the bulk of it went down to 40 kilometers an hour. There's nobody close to those roads. There's no houses close to those roads, to that road. I adapted after 35 or 40 years of driving that road. I drive it at 40 kilometers an hour. I don't have a problem with it. In fact, I've heard from two neighbors that they think it's a great idea because people come around the corners too fast. 40 kilometers an hour is not a crippling speed. If I did 50, I'll get out a little bit faster, but it's only seconds. I don't understand the fuss about seconds.
Obviously, you don't suffer from hypertension. Councillor Reynard.
I'm just going to, like, I'm not going to make a decision one way or the other right now. Hopefully, in the next 2 weeks, if there's people strongly opposed to raising it, they'll bring their thoughts forward, and then I'll make my decision.
Sure. Councillor Mill.
I think on the other side is
precipitated the change, because we took away the biking lane. So to make it safer for the bike, it was almost like we're putting the additional parking in to help with the overflow in the summer, and to compensate taking away that bike lane and to make it safer, because they came forward with their concerns, and rightly so. We thought, well, the compromise, well, let's drop it down to 40. In the summertime, July and August, it's too bad we couldn't put a time restriction on it and drop it to 40 in July and August, because in July and August, I think it absolutely has to be 40. Like Mayor Dave said, we're dropping our speed anyways, and I just naturally, because it is a hazard. The doors open out into the traffic, it's like trying to find the people crossing. During those 2 months, 50 is definitely too high, and I know that traveling back and forth. The rest of the year, that 40 pisses me off. Just gonna put it out there, you know. It is annoying to have to drop down. Then when you get behind some man driver, they're gonna be
loud. Well, you're just providing sound bites.
And then people always say women drivers, but some men drivers are driving.
I'm just wondering if you were upset about it. I'm not sure I got the message.
So I think there's two things. In July and August, absolutely that speed limit should be 40. For the rest of the year, should it be 50? Absolutely. Could there be a compromise? I don't know. I know they do that for out on the lake when they're doing speed restrictions. They have that opportunity to do them by month, by week, you know, by time of year. I know it's probably pretty onerous to do that. We need a good communication, education plan. So I'm thinking that, you know, because of how busy it is in the summertime and how busy we go on that water park. And by the way, how's it impacting the heat? That's what I'd like to know.
I think those streams along the...
I know, they seem to be working.
Well, all the stuff, yeah, the silhouettes and the made up.
No, I'm just throwing that out there, but because there are two sides to it. Both sides of that story are under
this has got more discussion than we did in the notice of motion.
Well, I think, though,
3 years ago.
Yeah, I think you may, and I'm glad to see there's somebody else with hypertension on council. the thing here is where we maybe made the mistake in the first place, is we didn't change, the only thing we changed originally was we didn't have to change the signs in the summer and winter, because you could park there in the summer, and nobody parked there in the winter anyway. It was like, let's just leave the signs up year-round, and that spirited this whole, let's drop it to 40. Nothing changed. Even the signs not being there didn't change anything. That's why going to 50, they're not going to do 50 in the summertime. That's the maximum. They're going to do 10, 20, 30, 40. And I don't go over there every day, just about every day. That's why I'm saying that 50 is going to work for the simple fact that people can't go in them 2 months when it's busy. It's just slowed right down. I sit in my office and I look out there every day, and I doubt if they're doing 10 for the most part. As soon as you hit the hospital bridge, you're right down because the traffic backs up and the speed manages itself. So we never should have changed it in the first place. We wouldn't have all this fun discussing it. But.
I just asked that Jeff Chet to see what I'm whether we want to look at doing the logistics behind that, because I know it's an education and communication thing. That's the biggest challenge right there.
Yeah. And that's what we wanted to get out of in the first place, and that for some
reason. That's why we opened up the
it's like the bridge, we got the 1.1.
1.083.
Okay.
Now, that wasn't officially top up, yeah.
No, that wasn't officially top up, that was a sweetheart deal. So, that might not, yeah, that might not, yeah. I won't say anymore. Okay, no brainer. 3.3, the Frayne Island parking lot tender.
So this is a report that recommending that Montrose tender submission for $284,212.30.
Jeff, that was less than our estimate, wasn't it?
It is less than our estimate, but we want to have a contingency in there.
Yeah, exactly.
It may turn out to be that the residents aren't having to contribute quite well to their original community if everything goes well. So it can be a positive step.
Thank you. Excellent.
You can come back when we go with that.
There you go.
Okay, municipal roadwork tender.
Again, this is recommending that we accept the tender submission by Montrose Construction of $1,203,011.93 for the 2018 municipal roadworks.
Councilor Mill?
Jeff, just a question, not on the decisions or anything. The location of the one that's the back lane downtown, is that the one that's directly behind Donovan's or one coming up? Is that one there is really, really bad?
Yeah, I I'd have to go back.
Is that the one part?
First Street is.
Yeah.
Okay, so what's
First
that
Street
one
coming this way,
there?
Yeah.
I have one question to you. So, Jeff, we have a budget. Any extra fund, because we set a budget of 1.45 approximately, right? We only spend 1.35. Do we have something else that we can use that extra 100 grand?
Yep.
So we use it?
Yep. And we, throughout the year, even though we do have a listing of locations, we don't generally release that publicly because this is very fluid and dynamic. So if we find that we have shortfalls and expenditures on certain projects, we'll move those on to other projects. And at the end of the year, if we're able to do more work.
Do we need to pay the program outside of that tax budget? If there is any already funds that aren't used, we put them back into the budget.
Okay, I was just wondering, based on the asset management plan, when they keep saying, want to make sure we spend what we've allocated.
There was one of their Kirkpatrick and Peter, but I'll talk to I don't need to know. I still probably have one right now. Just a taxpayer in there that won't be on a pretty regular basis.
Well, you should be happy to be in there.
Yeah. And actually,
raise some funds for the Kenora Rec Center, so to increase our operating budget. So what we're looking at doing is lots 1, 2, 3, and 4, which are the lots in the front of the Kenora Rec Center, will become 4-hour parking, and there'll be signage up there for 4-hour parking. And then lot 5, which is considered the trailer parking that you guys would see in the back right now, would have a fee structured to it. So the fee that we're looking at is similar to the parking lots that are down Harborfront and down over at Park Street, to be a $1 an hour or a $75 monthly parking pass. And similar with lot 7, which is currently the lot that's adjacent to lot 6, similar fees there as well. And hopefully those local businesses are utilizing in front of our parking lot right now will be similar to the businesses that are down Harborfront or Park Street and pay for parking there as well. So we've had chats with Bylaw and they're on board to start to take over recognizing those parking lots as City of Kenora or Bylaw enforced parking lots. So.
Perfect. Councilor Rayner. Before the meeting, would we be able to get a map?
Yeah.
So we can actually.
Yeah, I should have included
that.
I apologize.
Just,
yeah.
When you, there's so many different lots.
Yeah.
It just would really
yeah.
help so you could tie it into the report.
Yeah.
Thanks,
thank
Josh.
For sure.
I got one. Councilor Smith.
So some of those lots, Josh, at the rec center, they're designated for, say, trucks and trailers, park here for trucks and trailers,
yep.
Some are just for cars. One of the complaints I've heard is that people are parking with trailers where they probably shouldn't be, or cars are parking in those things. Are we actively enforcing that so that, like, leaving, when I say enforcing, leaving those, say, in the future or something, these lot, you're taking up spaces that can be better utilized for cars or trucks and trailers.
So currently that's an ongoing issue with staff over at the rec center,
yeah.
is that the maintenance operators and the people that are at the rec center do the best job they can to inform people that there's no single vehicle parking in the trailer parking because you're essentially taking up the full spot.
Yeah.
And similar to lot 7 where it's supposed to be single vehicle parking, we are going to allow lot 7 to be the overflow for trailer parking on busy days, August long weekends, that type of time frame. Right now they are putting notes or just notifying them. Enacting this will allow bylaw to enforce that a little bit more. As noted by bylaw, we have to do our due diligence at the rec center to have proper signage to inform everyone that this is where you park a vehicle and trailer, and if you don't park a vehicle and trailer, you could be ticketed, like if you're a single vehicle in there. So right now bylaw can't do anything. Enacting this will help that alleviate that concern.
And the signage thing is the one thing that they did say is we do need better signage down there, because if we're not telling people what to do, how can we pick them up? Right?
And there is signage there, to be fair to what is there. There is proper signage there right now. I think it needs to be better placed so that people, I mean, as much as everyone knows, people just drive by a sign and say, oh, I didn't see the sign. What sign are you talking about? It's right there. So it's just better placement and so forth. And we've worked with bylaw. There's two outstanding ticket machines that we will repurpose, the ones that were at Park Street and the Harborfront originally. So there won't be any incurred cost for having parking ticket stations. So
the other thing was Q8 and opening up that back lot is a good thing. And I don't know how many additional spaces you'll get. Usually what I find people doing back there is abandoning their trailers.
Yeah.
So they're just leaving them back there and taking up those spots.
And
but Q8 has a real bad problem. I know Kenora does too. The people are parking on the streets in Q8 for long periods of time and sometimes not utilizing the Q8 arena. Part of the problem might be that they have to come all the way over to Kenora to the rec center to get those parking tickets where they used to issue them at two years.
Yeah, so there is a plan in place for parking in Q8, and similar to what has been done in the past is if you're looking at parking overnight in Q8, you call the Kenora Rec Center, take down their information, and then Kenora Rec Center will notify bylaw that such and such vehicles park there and they won't receive a ticket. So there's still that process, and we're still trying to iron out that kink. But if you're parking in lot 6 overnight, you would still go into the rec center and get an overnight parking pass.
So last summer, in reference to the consultation, we worked really hard with the bylaw enforcement and our extra summer school.
Mm-hmm.
We
did.
Yeah, got busy with the law this year, so we did a lot of notices out.
mean, in Winnipeg, nobody would abandon their truck and their trailer in front of somebody's home on the street for days at an end, and I think that wasn't acceptable, but down here it seems to be different. So it's just gonna take people getting aware that we're serious about the. Yeah, there we go.
That's a message.
That's for sure.
You wouldn't want to do it in Winnipeg, because somebody would steal it.
Exactly.
Councilor McMillan?
I think too, and Heather can speak to this, is that should this get passed at council over the next little while, the kickback we'll see is that there'll be vehicles parked on the streets and illegally parked for a period of time, as people do that, like water finds its own level. So people will do that until they get accustomed to the fact that there's enforcement. So staff are going to go through a transition period for a little while. It could be a major part of the summer when this is implemented. So it happens.
Same one as last year?
Whoa.
I know, I was out front a few times.
Descriptive.
Okay.
Yeah, we're good.
Okay. Thanks, Josh. 4.2, accommodation tax bylaw. And keep on going.
Keep on going. Okay. So the recommendation here is there's actually two folds to this recommendation. So council did receive a deputation from Ken Host B&B. So after reviewing the deputation. The recommendation is that council hereby supports all bed and breakfasts to charge the municipal, still charge the 4%, but only up to 75% of their actual room rate, recognizing that 25% is the breakfast portion. So based on the actual loss of words, but came down from the Ontario government, we can only charge on the actual room rental. We can't charge on food or any of the extras going forward. So that was the compromise that we're looking for with B&Bs. I did talk with the City of Ottawa finance team, and that was based on their deputation. They originally had the tax across all accommodations, and it wasn't until there were some deputations from council, from B&Bs to council that they decided that they were gonna look at this, and some of the options they gave was the option that you guys have in front of us, plus also quarterly remittance for in conjunction with HST for those B&Bs. Unfortunately, they didn't decide that, and they went with an exemption policy. That said, not all B&Bs in Ottawa are exempt. They have to apply for it, and they have to meet certain credentials in order to do that B&B. The fear is, or the thought process is, we're such a small community that the recommendation came forward that if we allow one B&B or a small accommodation the opportunity to be exempt, we're going to have other smaller accommodations, such as maybe a Luby's who's four bedrooms, come forward and say, well, we're a smaller accommodation as well. So this just keeps it across the board. It doesn't create a competitive advantage for any small business or any small accommodation. So that's the recommendation going forward. And then the second part is that the Colonel Hospitality Alliance is looking for an extension on when the tax gets implemented. So from September 1st to October 1st, they're looking, since it's their busy season right now, they're just looking for an extra month in order to implement it. And in thoughts of keeping our partnership strong with the KHA, I think we should be granting the 1 month extension. So.
Yeah, I thought, I kind of wondered when I see that.
sure what the impact is there, perhaps parking, I'm not aware of that, but I would just like to see somewhere a proviso to ensure that the discussions and the dialogue continue so that we can try and work something out. And again, I preface this by saying I'm not against pickleball because it's another great activity and recreation in our community that can grow. I think we experienced that, I think it was last week or, last weekend or a couple of weekends ago that they had that tournament and it had a significant impact. But we've got other players that have been there.
Discussions will take place and make sure that there's an accommodation made.
Yep, thank you.
The only thing is, Josh, is the city's leading these discussions. We're not leaving the groups on their own to work this out. This is a city property and staff will be leading the discussion.
That's why I've already reached out to Borealis and the Rowing Club. And Karen was kind enough to give me the contacts for pickleball. So hopefully something will come this week.
So the pump's ordered, is that what you're saying?
I don't have an update on this thing, but I will get that weekend
going up. I was just curious, Karen, because if it happened in March and it's June now, and it's an issue.
It's my understanding that they have gone ahead, but I will...
I think it's already done. Okay, 4.5, budget amendment for the rec center 20.
Is this a juggling going on here this morning? Even amongst us.
Thank you.
question was, I don't know if I've ever received demographic, like I asked demographics for both major minor groups in terms of what their user numbers were 5 years ago and what they were this year. And also if we could access the demographics from both school systems, what their numbers were, so that girls and boys hockey, Karen, and 5 years ago and what they are today by the age group, so we can see, you know, is it still, there were 700 children playing hockey 5 years ago, and there's still, are they up or down significantly, so we can see what's going on.
Your trend.
And also the schools. So the number of children in schools is increasing, because we heard that children in care were increasing when we attended function with DSAB and with the separate school board and KCL. And the other thing I'm curious about is, suppose we build this new facility and if we rent it at 48 hours a week, I'm sorry, 64 hours a week. Yeah. And for a period of 6 months. So suppose it comes to 1600 or 1700 hours. We have an idea how we're going to rent that, because if we're only going to rent 800, then the deficit becomes significant. Like, we're at the point now where, you know, we're supportive to bring us to this point, but now it's kind of, once we make this final decision, we've invested $250,000 to have as-built drawings. I just want to have as much
information. Have the numbers first.
Well, as much information as we possibly can.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know if it's possible to say, again, there's so much information, I haven't had time to go through all my notes, the expected operating cost of that facility. Because if it's going to be, let's say it's going to cost 3% tax increase, or 1%, we need to, you know, as much information as possible to make that final decision. Because once we go beyond this step, pretty well in, at least for that quarter.
The commitment's made.
Not necessarily.
No, we're in for the $250,000 payment.
Yeah.
If the funding's approved.
Right.
And if the numbers, I think what you're saying, just get them numbers, still move forward with this, you don't necessarily have to spend it.
Okay.
If, and if we get the numbers and says no, well, then we get an approval from NHFC, and we say, whoa, hold on, the numbers don't warrant. So everything just goes on hold.
Well, I will make this commitment to council, because in journal impact period, the only person who has a sign off authority on something of that magnitude is the scale. If council subsequently says we're not in, you can rest assured that I'm not signing
it. Councilor.
I just want to follow up on a couple of things here. Dan raises some important points about cost recovery. We found out in that last report that our cost recovery is way too low, and we're going to have to be looking at those the cost recovery numbers in the future, and I would suggest in the near future. And I'm of two minds to that, because I know that ice time is expensive and it's prohibitive for many people. I don't like the idea of raising them, but still, I don't think it's that the rest of taxpayers should be subsidizing all the time either. So it is a bit of a quandary. So did you just say that even if we, if the numbers change and council changes its mind, if the NOHFC money comes through, we can still say, no, we're not going there?
That would be my understanding, yes. We can choose to not pursue the project. We will confirm that, I guess, the NOHFC, although
I can't. They don't like that, I know that. I know, so, but that's an option for us, and that's a good option for us moving forward. It makes it easier to make this decision.
I've always felt that it's at the discretion of council for the actual future.
So you're going to check on that?
I'm reluctant to make that call in.
I know, so, and I know it doesn't look good on us.
I mean, we can do that on our own.
Okay, so, and yeah, my other question.
It's not up to us.
And how about this? The claim that I already have was one NOHFC, and
so my last question is, and it was pertains to my first question, was the $250,000 debt financed, I think we did see the tables previously about over the years how much that's an impact on our budgeting and tax dollars. Why would we not look at taking that money from contingency if we go ahead? Because then that saves the debt payments, the servicing costs, it's saving taxpayer dollars moving forward. And we just heard a presentation that said we need to, once we start reducing our debt load and those interest payments, we should be driving that back into our infrastructure deficit. So we gotta remember that every time we incur debt, we set that asset management plan back further. So I guess I have a number of questions, Karen. I'm just throwing that out there.
Could I? Go ahead. I got Councilor Manolo and then Councilor Manolo.
I think what I will do, I just want to make sure I've captured everything. I will send out an email all the way to the committee of the whole, listing out what I've captured from the meeting, including any additional discussion that comes up. And I would ask each councilor to look at it and try to get back to the interview with the paper. So I think just to make sure I've fully captured it, go back to just give me an email that you have access to Matt's emails as well. And we'll see what we have or haven't sent. So if you send it, we'll resend it. If you haven't sent it, we'll try to get the information. I don't know if I can pull this together for you for the interview. So if that's the case, you'll know what you do or don't have, but at my point, council can make that make the decision if you want to table it for the July council meeting. Do you still have the authority to make that resolution in July?
We do have somebody very close in Canara here who I'm not going to mention that can maybe answer the NRSFC question. Councilman Hill?
Okay, I just want to put this in context. The April meeting, we agreed to proceed with submitting the application to NOHFC, which I'm sure has been done. So that's the case. So we're talking about saying no or saying yay. I think we should approach that cautiously. I think that's what people are saying. So our next step is to gather this information, some of the demographics or the data, to try and bring it forward for the June 20th meeting. But Dave, what I also heard you say is that, and I feel it may be advantageous for us to go ahead with identifying or approving the source of the 250, considering what Sharon has said about the cost and whether it should come out of contingency reserves and as that goes forward, because I mean the reality is there's a 50% chance NOHFC will say no and they will say yes. So I think to have our ducks in order and lined up to go, I don't dispute that the data required is necessary and perhaps some of that we should have had and we don't, but that's a reality. So if we bring this forward in 2 weeks to identify the source of funding, which was a commitment to bring forward to this meeting, which is the plan. And the other thing I want to say is just very generally, just to clarify that what we're funding is not another study. What it is the mechanical design structures, which is not a study. It's the document that should council continue to go forward, lets us go out and seek partners and seek commitments and to bring money to the table. It's not a study.
Okay, and then just follow up on one of Councillor Smith's points. When report came through in terms of what the subsidized rate per hour was, basis on what that was generated was not consistent with what was used when we last passed the other rates in terms of what expenditures.
Yeah, you're right.
So we need to be comparing apples to apples when it comes
sure.
through there. So I would like to see the reports that have been consistently over the years. This is the format for establishing that we continue to use that trend. Otherwise, we're just pulling numbers. I'd like to know why it's so varied. Like it was a huge So that means we're subsidizing 77%. Well, it's never, so we've got to be comparing apples to apples.
I've had concerns with this from the beginning, and I've noted it, and I think we've had some several votes on it. We've had a lot of discussion on it. I've always said that until I see a solid demographic study, I'm not going to go for it. I still will not go for it. I'm concerned that we go ahead and we authorize an expenditure of $250,000 of Kenora taxpayers' money and another $500,000 of Ontario taxpayers' money, that we're committing the next council to a project that they may not want, but they'll have a $750,000 set of drawings. I'm concerned about that because that puts an undue pressure on that council to say, to justify the expenditures that this council is making. I don't think that's fair.
Mort and I haven't agreed on this project, but I think where I do agree with what you said is if a decision is to be made, it should be this council making the decision one way or another. I'm not sure if that's what you said, but
I don't think so.
Okay. No, that's not going to happen. That's the problem. The time frame is that's not going to happen. And so, I mean, totally understand, you know, what Councillor Goss is saying here. It's June, folks.
Yeah.
We have a month left. Until lame duck, so it's, it's not going to happen. You wouldn't even have your answers back. So, I mean, we've got 2 weeks to try and get a couple answers. One, maybe we can get a little later today, and then go from there. There's still no need to put the money out. Still no need to put any money out. So, that's all I want to say on that right now. No need to put any money out. Okay? Okay. 4.6, done. 4.7, done. 4.8, no, 4.7.
We're doing it.
Well, let's just go back to hitting the wall. So, the report here just details that we're going to apply under the new Horizon for Seniors grant program to receive $25,000 towards the port conversion project at Garrow. Of course, the latest quote that we have, require another funding source as well as we use the donations that Pitbull has already received. But the hope is that we can leverage these dollars to have a greater chance of gaining some other funding from the controlling capital finder source.
Good job. Thanks, Adam. You're going to become the Ontario grant champion here. For
No. Keep, that's an internal grant champion. We're not going to publicize
No.
that.
No.
It's money on the side.
Percentage requested. Great stuff.
When we need to increase our assets, we'll market it.
Okay, 4.8.
You know what I? Oh, sorry, Councillor Rainey.
There's going to be a lot of questions from the media after this. So, are you going to address them, or is the Kenora Municipal Nonprofit Housing Corporation going to address those, or?
I think at this point it would probably be better to
it's an exciting project, but
I think on the one side, and I think you're right, and there's going to be a question. I think on the other aspect is just with what we've seen out of our asset management plan. Wow, this is going to help it a lot.
Oh yes,
on more ways than one, not just with stormwater tax. I mean, it's going to help it a lot. And I think it's a big bonus on revenue from all the way around, which is, and plus the issue with the housing issue we've got. So I think it's a win-win-win. So. Okay. Okay, 4.9.
Maybe in here, but I can't seem to find it. So you're gonna, the plan is to bring an access road onto, is that correct?
Essentially.
Whose responsibility is it to build that road?
They
accept 100% of the cost. Thanks.
Good project. Very good project.
4.10. Basically, to streamline, by the time I got to this on the plane reading it, my eyes were starting to close. I don't understand it, but thank you for putting the PDF so I can actually read it now when I'm gone instead of the SharePoint, which you can't open on right now. But yeah, to streamline and you know, we've been talking about this for a long time, customer service, and let's make things happen, less on the roadblocks. So I didn't digest the whole thing. If that's the direction we're going, read it in case there's something, you know. Well, I missed a lot.
Did I miss something that we were, did we do the site plan control?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
That was the one we just, no.
Okay. It's been a long 4 days.
Well, that happened to me on the plane.
Oh, Katrina. You get up at 3 o'clock in the morning to go catch a plane. It's 2 hours difference, right? So you get early flights. No excuse. I just, I read it, but I missed it. I'm human, I guess.
I think this is great. It's going to certainly extend a lot of cellular service. Further north, I think they still have one more to go to hit Black Sturgeon area properly. But
this is a concern I had with it. I don't have a concern. It's great. It's all good. But I'm going, why did they pick that hill?
I'm not sure.
That's not very far out.
I would think that the hill by at Alcox with the just at the Carlton Road would be the height of land.
Yeah, and then you're closer to the Black Sturgeon thing. It says it's gonna, but when you take a look at the Black Sturgeon and the map here, what it's covering, it stops short of my place. That might not be a bad thing.
take responsibility for bringing this one up. Do we as a council, I know it's a sensitive area, do we as a council have any appetite to advocate at all for the retention of Pine Grove Hall?
They reversed their decision on that.
Changed.
Oh, they did.
Yeah.
When did it change?
Good work.
Just years ago.
Good work, Councilor McMillan. That was a lot of
talk. Oh, I can take responsibility for that. Oh, I didn't realize that. No, I've been away, so I. Yeah. Oh, that's good news. Okay. The second one is I had sent something out to council last week, just an article that was in the paper and on CBC about the attitude and the racism in a hockey arena in Quebec. And I know we don't have. We don't have the authority or we don't have the power to change people's attitudes and comments. And I believe firmly that our staff and council have done a very good job and a very positive job in cultural sensitivity training and engaging and building partnerships and relationships. I just wondered if council had the appetite for having a discussion at our July meeting, just a brief discussion, if there's anything we can do to advocate with other municipalities about the treatment within city-owned facilities. And I know our staff have every confidence in our staff, for example, at the rec center and the Q8 facility, that do their best to not tolerate racism and prejudice. And I guess this really hit home after my experiences in life, but also just the Richard Watkins book and the impact of the hockey. And I just want to know if council would have an appetite for this, because I think it's a, when I read that last week, it's just like our society went back 50 years just to hear those kind of comments. So I could try and prepare something for a discussion. I don't know exactly what we could do aside from advocate with NOMA and AMO and FCM to reinforce policies that address anti-racism and prejudicial comments upon any culture and any society. So that's my request for council for consideration. I think it's a critical issue in society today. So I just put that out there. Any interest in having that discussion. My third item is, just very briefly, I was never a real proponent of attending FCM. I thought it was a long way to go and a lot of money, but after attending one FCM and the format that they use and the discussion and the dialogue and the opportunity for networking with people right across the country. For example, I think, Jeff, there may be some people from Northern Saskatchewan that are going to get a hold of the city about the downtown revitalization project, because they're going through that now and they're looking for input. It was very positive, so I believe council should always support a member of council attending an FCM if at all possible and if it's in the budget, and it can be anyone around the table. And I think it's also important that a staff person go, because a number of staff people, like clerks and administrators that are at these conferences and the dialogue and the networking, the separate sessions they have for them is very positive. And just on a closing note, at the end, the last session on Sunday, Dave, you were there on Sunday afternoon, there was a panel of three people up there talking about collection of data and the new world out there and what's our country going to be like in 2040. There was a young fellow up there talking about the millennial population. And he made a comment that, and he put it in positive context, the millennials, when they go to buy a cup of coffee, they're not prepared to wait 5-10 minutes, not because they're impatient, but that's their world. And then so he took that and he crossed it over to how it can work with the municipality, so that if you want to encourage young people to come to your community and your municipality, and they go to get a building permit or something to change a house or whatever, put things in place where we can accomplish
Councilor Smith's buddy. She likes to read. He was there. He was one of the presenters in that three.
What's that guy's name?
I told Sharon on the way in this morning.
That was Guy Good, was from Tamarack.
Tamarack.
Yeah. Somebody else, aren't Gord Hume, is he?
No, not Gord Hume. No, I've known Gord Hume very well. No, this was a different guy, and Rory said that you...
We have to think of his name.
This is a classic seniors moment.
The millennials sitting around here definitely have time for us to think this one through.
I think it was Bruce Dorn, and he's from originally from the Manitoba area, and he was at Tamarack Institute. I'm sure you've been to one of those.
I keep saying every counselor in their term should go to one of the Tamarack conferences. Absolutely.
Yeah. It was.
Thank you. I'm done.
Great. Paul Bourne.
Paul Bourne.
CEO. CEO of Tamarack Institute.
Councilor Smith?
I have a couple of things, and I'm glad Rory brought up the article he sent out about the harassment discrimination when it came to Indigenous coffee thing. We do have a harassment and discrimination policy, but I really think that policy needs to be zero tolerance. And then we have to have the proper procedure in place that says if that happens in our recreation facilities, this is what staff are going to do. Because I was really appalled in the article when the coach had said, hands tied, I don't know what we're going to do. Staff said, hands tied, I don't know what we're going to do. So we do have that policy. It should be zero tolerance. And this is what staff are going to do. Coaches, you're going to be responsible. Your team is off the ice. I have no problem throwing somebody, some team off the ice if the coach is going to allow that to happen. Or spectators out of the stands. I mean, Kenora's been really moving ahead in this area, and I think that we need to keep doing that. And when Lori talked about Indian Horse and the museum, and the museum staff, Lori Nelson and Lynn Pauley, deserve recognition for bringing Indian Horse to Seven Gens for three nights, and the panel discussion that happened afterwards. And I know the museum has been very instrumental in moving that issue forward. And to bring that opportunity into our community, to have a small group citizen conversation, that's the education, the advocacy that we need to keep doing. So I think they need to be recognized for that. So I think we're moving forward in a good way. My other comment was we did a family internment at the cemetery this weekend. And this was my cousins and with my aunt. And they came from BC and from Winnipeg. And they've commented on our cemetery. They said that our website, they've never seen a website like that for cemeteries. You can look up any information about people that are interned there. They were just so impressed by the information that we have on site and the information they were able to find out about their family. The cemetery, how beautiful it is and well kept it is. They talked about our ice candle ceremony. And so I think that that recognition has to be passed on to our cemetery staff. The one thing I didn't agree with was how beautiful it was to see the deer there. I had to stop and
come. Wait till the geese come.
Exactly. So those are my comments.
Thanks. Councilor Goss.
Yep. Summer's moving along. There's two events that I'd like to bring attention to. The farmer's market begins on June 20th. And on June 21st, I would like to really make sure that as many people as possible attend the National Indigenous Peoples Day celebrations at Anishinaabe. Fantastic stuff. I'm 100% behind everything that they've done. This is a potential for an ongoing event that might qualify for further funding. They need the support. We need the community to come out there and see what's going on there. That said, I'm going to put on my flameproof suit and get ready for those phone calls about the 50. Speed limit.
Mort, you can blame me.
I have.
He did already.
I didn't miss that part.
Councilor Andrew, you good? Yeah, it's unfortunately I won't be here on the 21st. I have probably got a lot of emails to respond to there now, and I'll be at my AMO, NOMA and the AMO board meeting. But it looks like it's going to be a great event and a great time. Just to follow up on Rory's stuff on FCM, there was a great conference, a couple days of warm weather and a few days
days of very cold weather in Halifax, and as the mayor said, this is Halifax, and that's what happens.
Or it's a four season.
We can get all four seasons in one conference. And it was interesting. There were a few things, a couple of the exhibits. It's the largest exhibit show, I think, ever. Remember when we were in Winnipeg Exhibit Hall and that? This was bigger. It was amazing. I mean, the stuff they had there. The thing is, you can spend all your days just trying to go through the exhibitors and stuff with all the information and stuff, and you get there. And I did pick a couple of things I don't want to talk about, but it was all the way around. It was good. There was also and this is the thing with the big picture, and if you don't think you're part of the big picture, the first speaker, David Collette of Abascus Data, that young fellow, the millennial,
yeah.
Boy, he gave a big picture and where we're going. And if you don't think we're going there, sorry, folks, we're already there. That's where we are, and it's a changing world, a massively changing world. And so it was, like, the whole thing was good. One of the other things that I was took a fairly large part in was there was an emergency resolution to come forward. We met on Friday night with four provinces on the SAR, the species at risk stuff that's coming down from the federal government that's impeding on provincial governments, which they don't have the right to do, but they're saying, well, if you don't do this, and it's to do this one, it's to do with caribou, but it's a bigger picture. And we had people from BC, from Alberta, from Ontario, from Quebec, and the ones in some of the Maritimes come up to us after because they haven't, and they're going to start getting involved. The fact that the federal government is just doing blanket stuff without having municipalities at the table and First Nations to bring. We met the day before in Ottawa with the Northern Caucus of the government and about the exact same thing. And it's amazing to watch all these provinces, the municipalities in these provinces starting to pull together and say, whoa, hold on a minute. This has got to stop. We have to be at the table for the implementation of these things. So it went through at about, it was around 80% of area, I think 78.9 or something like that. Obviously, there's always people opposed. Here's the funny thing. When you're doing the votes, we have these voting tabulators. And when you're doing the votes, like a vote that is like a no-brainer, it's beneficial to everybody, and still 5.6% will vote against it. And it was funny because the president was saying,
it was consistent.
Yeah, it's always consistent. Why do 5% always vote against? It doesn't matter what it is. There's always 5% to vote against. It was kind of funny. But it was really good. It was really kind of neat. Met a lot of new people, new contacts when doing this this whole SAR thing, and probably now going to get, at least when the emergency resolution comes from the Federation of Canadian Municipalities, it means a lot. It's going to make a big difference, and it was not. We're opposed to the species at risk. That's not at all, and that's what we've consistently said. It's about who's at the table, and whose science are they using? Because even the Ontario science is so far ahead of the federal government in this, and BC has done a similar. Alberta's done a similar. They've done some similar stuff with their MNR there, and it's like the dots aren't connecting. So you get bad legislation that puts people out of work and hurts communities because one special interest group made a presentation and the government bought into it without talking to the people that actually live on the ground, that actually live and work in these areas. So it was really important, and I think the whole opportunity to bring all these different provinces together on an issue that's very important to everybody was a great thing. A couple of things here, and Jeff, give you any more work, you're already doing it very well to start with. But going around, we were talking about the water meters, and brought up council about people that end up having leaks and don't know it, and people that might bypass meters. And so I was talking with the Neptune people there for quite a while, and I was explaining to her the different things, and her, him, whoever it was, explaining some of the issues we have, and I know some other systems like International Falls, for instance, they can tell you if your toilet's running in the collier or whatever. There's different technology. And she says, "Oh, Kinara, we work there." I says, "Yeah, I remember the water meters. I really remember the water meters because I remember an election when I was the only mayoralty candidate that said he was putting them in, and it didn't go over real well." But they have some great technology, even better. Like, it changes all the time, and there's some opportunities there. And the other one, and this one, and I'd heard about, Jeff, you probably already know about this stuff.
is this Python 5000. The company's out of Regina, and this is that pothole patcher. It's not cheap, but it's, and this is the newest version. This is the old one, whatever. This one is apparently far superior. One person, everything's there. It blows. It in 2 minutes you can do a pothole. It's, and it was funny watching the videos, and the stuff it puts in when it's done lasts longer than the pavement around it. And it's so I think we probably have, I've seen, you know, maybe 2, 3, 4, 5 guys out doing potholes. And this thing, it's not cheap. It's the price of a grader. But
it's expensive, and the big issue is it's a lot of maintenance.
Yeah, and this might be the newer version that doesn't have that issue as much. But anyway, I just some stuff for you there, and it was kind of interesting. And another one there that kind of caught me as changing, these people are doing work right here. And the filtration resources, and it was a, basically, you know, I was talking about all our lift stations, and he says, we're the answer. It's too late now because we've already got that. But these people, this company, is actually doing a project at Longbow Lake, the Jetta Park, where they put in a smaller sewage treatment plant. It's a different system. And for, you know, $400,000, it'll take, I forget how many customers and stuff, and kind of neat. And it's just the way, you know, technology is changing so much on so many things, and you know, a place like that, you get the opportunity to run into them people. I mean, as you know, on good roads, I mean, the amount of suppliers and stuff there with the new stuff, and I know the staff that we took there last year were pretty keen on some of the information that was there. So that's the other positive side of the whole conference, is that a lot of great information and breaking sort of new technology. So other than that, if anybody wants, I got the book here if you want to go through it and on everything that went on. If you got any questions about any of the workshops, just ask Councillor McMillan.
I'll do my best. I can answer the ones I went to.
Okay, motion to adjourn to a closed session.
Resolution number 2, moved by myself, sent by Councillor Goss, that this meeting now be adjourned to a closed session at 11:40 a.m. and further that pursuant to Section 239 of the Municipal Act 2001, as amended, authorization is hereby given for committee to move into a closed session to discuss items pertaining to the following: 1, personal matters about an identifiable individual. 1 matter.
All in favor?
Aye.